Hello, hello, everybody. This is Aquas with the SDG Weekly, number 21. Here we are again. SDG Weekly stands for Shooting Game, stands for Shmup. You could call it the Shmup Weekly. And here we are once again. And this week's game is going to be G Stream G. Yeah, that's pretty bad. G Stream G 2020. Okay, interesting title. And going to be joined from by Trap 15. Seen him on the show before. Hey, Trap.
Yo, yo, yo.
And BP, like the fuel station. He's also joining Hello. Us. And they're going to be definitely talking about G Stream, G 2020, and what the hell is going on. Okay. I'm getting kind of confused because someone's saying it's breaking up, but I think we're okay. But yeah, so this is, should be quite a more informative episode than last week's, which was on Choaniki Sayonara Protein, which was basically just a complete shit shoot of an episode. So this one is actually going to be somewhat serious, and we're trying to learn something about G-Stream G2020. And check out, we're going to be watching a couple replays from the game as well. And definitely we'll learn about what those replays are from these guys. So BP or Trap, do you want to explain kind of the basics of this game and kind of what is it exactly?
Sure, I'll take that. G-Stream G2020 was released in 2003, I believe it was. By
2002.
Oh, 2002. Okay.
Yeah.
By
same year as Trollstag.
Oh, really? I didn't know that. That's interesting. But it was released by a Korean company's division in Japan, which had the lead, the CEO, president, etc. of Triangle Service, and the musician for Triangle Service, and the lead artist for Raiden Fighters series on their team somehow. And they made this extremely unknown but incredibly deep and satisfying shooter, G-Stream G2020, which is extremely underrated. Nobody knows about it. Very little of the mechanics are known. It's quite out there.
Yeah,
but
so yeah,
it's very much a golden hidden gem.
Hidden gem, okay. Yeah, it should be a great episode. So we're finally going to figure out what the hell is going on in this game, huh? Okay.
Yep.
All right. Well, I don't know. Yeah, I want to go into the basics of like the power ups and shot types and that type of thing.
It sounds like our audio is
dipping
out or something.
According to the
chat.
Every 20th word. That might be for only some people.
Oh, so I guess just try reloading. Oh.
Okay.
Oh dear. It looks like there's a few people having problems. And the actual, I don't know if you're pausing the video or whatever, but it's actually the video playing, because I've got Twitch TV running now, and that's actually looking a bit skippy with the frames as well. So.
Oh, really? All right. No problems for other people.
Interesting.
Yeah, is there like a quality setting on the player or something you can, or that a person can use, or
no.
I'm not familiar with this, but
yeah, there isn't, which sucks, but
yeah,
sometimes Twitch just does that where it's really jittery and whatever.
I think we're okay. I think people are just kind of having various All
right.
issues.
Yeah,
and you don't need to watch it either, BP. So I mean, Whatever.
Okay.
Yeah. I just had it up for the chat, to be honest. So.
Okay.
Alright. So, the power-ups, you have a bar of 10 item slots, which are, it's sort of like Trizeal in that sense, where you can have multiple weapons all equipped at once at different power levels. But the difference is, in this, you have a set number of power-ups, and you can allocate how much power to each t- type as you'd like. And if you grab, like, say, 10 of the red power-up, then you get a really powerful red shot, but you don't get any of the others. And then for the power-ups, there's the red power-up, which is your normal spread shot, nothing special there. And then blue is a straight-firing laser that is piercing and does quite a good amount of damage. Mm-hmm. And there's the green weapon, which is just a homing missile. And let's see. So,
okay. So
yeah, most people say the homing missiles are pretty useless in this game. But yeah. M-Tomb, the guy that's made the clear videos that we're watching today, actually disagrees. He's actually looked through them before, and he's actually switched completely to missiles for one of the later stages because he's found it more easier to use. To be able to defeat the bosses, because there's actually a point where a boss goes to a lower point of the screen and the other weapons just can't hit it at all.
Mm-hmm. Ah, interesting.
So there's a bit of... it has its uses, you know?
Right.
So did you say you can switch the weapons on the fly?
No, you have to pick up new power-ups and it'll shift off the last power-up you grabbed. So say you grabbed 10 reds, and then you grabbed a green, it would drop off that first red that you grabbed and replace it with a green. And so then it's sort of a way of just keeping your power-ups cycling through.
So that's the bottom left, like...
yeah, that's what the little bar on the bottom left is.
Okay.
And let's see, past that, there's metals which drop from the majority of enemies. I can't remember if it's all of them, but I believe it's just the majority. But there's 10 metal levels, I think. And so you can pick up the first one is 100, then 200, 300, 400, 500. And then it goes to 1,000. Then it goes to 1,000. And then 5,000, and then 10,000, I believe. And once it hits 10,000, it doesn't go any higher.
I thought it only went as far as 1,000.
Oh, does it?
Because it started from, like, 10 or something.
Okay, yeah. Divide all the numbers I said by 10, and that should be right. so it's something along those lines, but it's... the metals drop really fast, so if you don't know that they're going to come out, you're probably going to miss them. And it does take quite a bit of effort to try to catch them all, and that's a big reason to use the blue laser, is because then you can only hit things in front of you, which will make sure that you're going to catch most of the metals.
Okay, and how do they, do the metal values go down, or how do they go down?
So each time you collect a medal, it raises up the medal chain. But if there's multiple medals on screen and you collect all of them, then it still increases it multiple times. Mm-hmm. And it's easier to see when the gameplay is actually rolling and I can explain it as I'm seeing it.
Okay.
But it's...
yeah, it's a bit different from Battle Gregor in the sense that all the medals on the screen, you add it and then it just keeps going up regardless of what the medal looks like, so...
yeah.
Okay.
And dropping one medal will kill the chain, as usual. But for the most part, the medals aren't too important except for some key parts where you can use what's called the Void Bomb, where it will create like a little cancel radius wherever the Void Bomb hits a bullet, and then all bullets that hit the Void Bomb turn into metals of your current metal chain.
Ooh.
And dropping any of those metals has no penalty, and the metal chain won't rise past that either.
Yeah, it locks the metal value in place, doesn't it?
Yes, it does.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then there's just a normal bomb where you the longer you hold it, the further up the screen it goes, and if you hit something with the bomb while it's rising, it'll explode in place. And I think that's about it.
Cool.
Yeah, you get a few frames of invincibility when you use the bomb, don't you?
I believe you do. And if you like physically run into an enemy while the bomb is being released, then the bomb explodes in place and you take no damage.
Sweet. All right, well, I guess we have some good preliminary information in stock at this point then, and as the replay goes on, we can point out anything else that needs to be said, but I don't know, are we ready to check out the replay then?
I think we are.
Okay.
Yeah?
Great. All right, I shall do a countdown in a moment. All right. 3, 2, 1, click.
All right.
Cool. Yeah, I'm definitely seeing some kind of like Raiden fighters influences in this game. It looks pretty interesting.
Oh yeah, it's all the art is actually done by the main artist for the Raiden Fighters series, so the art is beautiful.
It gives it a nice appeal for that.
I also noticed with the font used in the main menu, if you actually compared that to what's in Raiden Fighters and stuff, it is precisely, it's the same font, minus a couple of alterations with a few pixels, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's almost just like, reuse the font and then everything else has been made in the same style, but new and cutting edge sort of thing.
All right, so a thing that we're seeing here that I didn't explain yet is you notice sometimes there's the pop-up of the score number 5,000, and that happens just like in Raiden Fighters when you destroy multiple enemies at a time. And depending on... I can't remember. Is the value different depending on how many you kill at a time, or is it...
Thing they never really figured out, to be honest, but it does seem to go up by a certain value. So you sometimes you see it goes to 5,000 and then 6,000,
right,
all the way up to 10,000 if you're really friggin' lucky and good at pulling it off.
Right, and
I think in the replay a few times he's managed to get it to 7,000 or 8,000, which is not bad at all.
Yeah, definitely, and. You also noticed if when he picked up extra red power-ups with a full red power-up meter, he got 10,000 points for picking each one up, which is actually a pretty significant bit of score, I believe. And so then here, what he's doing is he's destroying individual parts to drop the medals, which are worth more than most of the rest of it, actually.
You can actually blow those engines as well.
Yeah, but they're a lot harder to do with red shot than the laser, because you end up hitting the actual plane itself.
At stage 2 now, aren't we?
Yep. So, he just got this warning screen, and that comes from if you destroy all of the tanks that were rising in the very beginning, then it pops up that screen with warning, and then there's a huge field of tanks.
That's pretty weird, man. None of the tanks shot at him. They just sit there.
They do shoot at you, but it takes a while for them to actually do that. So it does give you a little grace period before they start trying to kill you.
Yeah, this looks so much... Oh, man, yeah, that Raiden art, yeah, you're right. It's just So reminiscent. Yeah. Especially the like the watery puddles that have the sky reflected in them.
Yeah, I've always loved that about Raiden Fighters, and it really blew me away to see that in this as well.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. So from what I've heard so far, it seems like it's a fairly straightforward game.
Yeah, for the most part. The biggest complexity for scoring, at least, is knowing when to use your Void Bomb. Okay. And where to keep your Metal Chain up.
Okay.
And also the other part that we kind of haven't really dealt in detail yet is the altering of the stage as well, because I mean there's you know, some areas are more rewarding for score than others, so it's
right. So depending on how fast you kill things, you actually unlock different parts of the stage, so you can go along multiple paths in the actual stage itself by killing things faster or killing things slower. And as BP just said, some parts are worth more than others, but it's not necessarily always the one that you killed the fastest that's worth more.
Definitely makes playing playing it a bit more interesting, because it's like each time you play you can kind of like mess around and you go somewhere else and it's like, oh, how did that happen? Or
yeah exactly. It gives you a lot of replay value, and there's lots of little cool things to explore and just play around with, really.
Alright, go ahead, BP.
Yeah, we're on stage 3A now, aren't we?
Yep.
Yeah, because of... Yeah, the main thing I sort of wanted to mention was, you know, in regards to the stage altering, because we only figured out, you know, how to get from, you know, from 2 to 3A when we want to, or to 3B when we want to, this, you know, just this week, thanks to the guy that came up with this video. We've been at it for a while, and what it actually is you actually go to a certain side of the screen when you destroy the boss, just before your ship takes off and you see stage clear appear on the screen. And what side of the screen you're on actually determines which of the alternate stages you go to. Oh. So if you're on the left side of the screen, it takes you to 3A and 5A, so on. And if you're on the right side of the screen, it takes you to the B stages.
You'd think they could, like, point that out for you, like...
Yeah, it's fairly obtuse. I actually was starting to think it was, like, randomly generated or something. You
yeah,
know,
it was, I always
I was at it for
it was,
weeks,
yeah,
and got
I always
fed up with
it. Was random. So, that was kind of a goddammit moment.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely one of the big mysteries of this game revealed, that's for sure. Would have been nice if we knew that back when we were Trap 15 was trying to fix the music, that's for sure.
Yeah, it took Dave K a while to get recordings of all the stages for me, just because he couldn't figure out how to get between 3A and 3B.
Oh, doing a little Strikers action here. The boss coming out of the boss type thing.
Yep.
And forming into a bigger boss. That was pretty badass,
yeah.
Actually. That was cool.
Yeah, the 3B boss is actually something huge as well, because it's like a big-ass friggin' tank. It sort of looks a bit like if anyone's played the third stage of 12 Stag. It looks a bit like that, but even larger still. You can sort of see the resemblance, that's for sure. Regarding with the... if you're in the middle, I think it's randomly generated as well, but I'm not absolutely certain about that regarding the stage alterations. Just to answer the guy that was in the chat just then.
Yeah. What about,
as far as extends go, I believe there are no extends at all. So you have 3 lives, and that's it.
Yeah. There is sprite data for extends in there, but we've... It just seems to not be used, or it's another obtuse secret that we haven't figured out yet. I wouldn't be surprised if that was the case either.
Yeah, that's entirely likely, knowing this game.
So we're at stage 4 now, aren't we?
Yep.
Yeah, stage 4 has a lot of alternating segments as well. It's, I think we're on Red Sea now, where it's gone to that, which was pretty... That's pretty simple to get into, actually. It's just wiping out everything quickly, as you said before.
Right, and I'm still not clear. There's actually a purple sea that you can get into, but I watched M-Tomb's replay, and I couldn't really figure it out how he got into it.
Yeah. I think it's a bit of quick killing and stuff, but there's a few other enemies that are a bit, how do you put it? You know, when they're very close to the edge of the screen and you can barely see it.
Oh.
Because there's a few enemies like that that pop up, and he had to make very sure to get rid of them all. But it should be just coming up now, I think.
I don't think he actually goes to the Purple Sea in this.
Really? Oh.
Yeah. It might be in the other replay.
I thought it was in this one, but
yeah, I watched this one earlier today, so I don't remember there being the Red Sea, but I could be wrong. I have terrible memory after all.
You and me both.
Oh, okay. Yep, I guess he does.
He turned purple.
Yep, there it is.
Someone spiked the Kool-Aid.
To answer the question in the chat, no, there is no autobomb. And, the port is going to be very, very nice. I'm very excited for it.
Yeah, I hope so too. It's definitely going to be good. It's a sort of a bit of a mystery in itself about the port as well, because, I mean, you see... Fujino has said that it's going to be, how's the words he used it, like a different game based on G-Stream G2020 Delta Zeal, which is what it's going by now.
A different game,
but as to what differences those are, no one knows.
Right, and as far as region-free, yes, it will be region-free. Has been confirmed. Multiple people emailed them and got that response.
It's pretty cool. It's really nice.
Wouldn't have pre-ordered it if it wasn't region free.
Yeah,
it's going to be very, very nice. I'm really excited for it. Okay, so here he actually starts picking up the green homing missiles. Yeah. And as BP said, he will fully transition to the homing missiles in this stage.
Oh, I see. So the power, it's like filling up from the
other end. It drops off the power up that's on the left and replaces it with the one that you pick up.
Okay. That's kind of cool in a weird way.
Yeah, it's very... It's... I don't think I've seen it in any other STG. And
it's nice. Kind of neat.
Yeah, I think the only other case where it was used in similar form is, well, Trizeal by Triangle Service, which they seem to have taken almost the same system and modified it slightly so that you could just level up your weapons separately and use them at once. But apart from that alteration in that game, I've not seen anything like this anywhere.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah, there's a lot of little references to this game in Trizeal and 12 Stag, which came after this game. So, they have a lot of shared mechanics and just a lot of little similarities. There's even some stage designs that are very similar, and they really like this game, I take it.
Cool.
Yeah, 12 Stags actually got quite a few shared mechanics. I mean, at first it seems like a completely different ball game because of the, you know, the wobble shot. But when you actually, you know, play the games more thoroughly and see that most of the early stages also do the alternating, it's quite interesting indeed. I actually ended up buying 12 Stag after playing this game and giving it a spin on the computer and made sure to get the PS2 port.
Yeah, I was considering getting it, but, you know, having that also going to be on the Delta Zeal package is quite a sweet addition, and it's makes buying that even more worth it.
Yeah, it's quite fitting when you think about it that that 12 Stags being included, because considering they're made in the same year, you know, from with one being before they had the Triangle Service name and one afterwards, so.
Yeah.
I'm a little bit behind on the video, but we're just at the boss now, eh?
Yep.
Yeah.
There we saw him, yeah. There's definitely here where you can see why he used the missiles, where it goes down to the bottom of the screen and back up the top again.
Oh, right.
Yeah. And that way you deal more damage and stuff to it for a longer period of time, and it just makes it more easier to deal with.
I see. To answer another question in the chat, do you know if there's rank in the game? As far as I know, there is no rank in this game at all.
Dude, nice background.
Yeah, the background in this stage is very nice. It's one of my favorite backgrounds.
It turned nighttime. That was badass, dude. I've never seen that before.
Yeah, very nice view, that one. And I do agree with the SimCity 2000 look. It does look a lot like it.
They like SimCity.
And that's not a bad thing either.
It's another it's another reference.
I'm gonna take this off of Makaz's comment. Triangle Service did get screwed by Oriental Soft with this game. As far as public knowledge goes, this is the game that Fujino was talking about in his love letter that he wrote after the release of Trizeal, where he asked everybody to buy his game because he needed people to make ends meet. And he described how he basically got screwed over by Oriental Soft, who stopped paying his salary halfway through the game's development, and he wanted to make another game, 12 Stag, but he couldn't get any, he couldn't get project allocation for it, so he ended up leaving and formed Triangle Service.
Interesting. Okay. So it's kind of had a rough times.
Yes, very, very rough.
Interesting.
And, it's quite an interesting story.
Yeah, definitely, I think, yeah, it's what I've been saying, you know, with this port that's coming up, this Triangle Service pretty much need all the money they can get from this, because it's definitely, how do you put it? Like, it's... I'm not sure whether this one will sell very well. I imagine it would, being region free and whatever else, but at the same time, it's not a... It was quite rare for a long time, you know? I mean, G-Stream was not one that a lot of people knew about. It's, even in the Japanese pages, we couldn't find a hell of a lot.
I see.
And it certainly didn't help that the boards were faulty and they would overheat and actually make the board warp and traces would break and then the board would stop working.
Oh no.
Yeah, and it's extremely rare board to get and extremely expensive. It's like $700 or something like that. So it's definitely not a common game and definitely not cheap.
Speaking of the board, though, it's interesting to see that the version we're running now is the one that's most commonly seen in MAME with the plain title screen, but we have seen a couple of pictures of what appears to be a later version of the game that actually features the ship featured in the title screen. And this also shows in the 360 port, Delta Zeal, so...
Huh.
Be interesting to see that there's possibly like a later board revision floating around out there, but I imagine it'd be even rarer than what we've seen so far.
Yeah. And let's see. So in the chat, Triangle Service is definitely a very, very cool company. They're all about the shooting games. It's Fujino's passion, and that's pretty much the only stuff that they've made aside from a recent re-release of Sega's Pango on Nessica, I believe. Is that what it's on? Yeah, it's...
I think it was on Nessica, yeah.
Yeah, it's cool. I'm down with the Pango.
Pango? What the hell?
But, yeah, they're very much about the shooting games, so definitely give them your support. We need more shooting game companies.
More awesome stuff like this from Triangle Service, too.
Oh, yes, for sure.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, it seems like whenever there's, like, a new release, like, shooting game release, whether it be a port or whatever... Like, it always seems like it's, like, the companies are on their last breaths, like, trying to get these games out. And, like, we're still getting some, so it's, like, you really gotta show your support if you are interested. Because there may come a time when no shooting games will ever be released anymore, unless, like, they're indie or whatever. So, definitely gotta, like, support it.
Yes, as I mentioned earlier, the 12 Zeal and Delta Zeal collection is indeed region free.
Yeah, exactly. So it's like, it's pretty fortunate to have that be the case.
Yeah, for sure.
Very fortunate. I mean, it's just like, I would have thought like shooting games would be the last games to be region free, you know? Because they're so like niche and that type of thing, and maybe nobody really cares about them. But the fact that they are, less like it kind of seems like it's a nod to like the other people who do enjoy the games, but
yeah.
on like a small, very small basis.
Yeah, and this game in particular is definitely the last one I would have expected to get a 360 port. To be honest, that is.
Yeah, I was thinking that maybe out of the blue there. Yeah, I was like pretty afraid that like the source code was lost or something, because you know it's definitely not really a company you would expect to keep track of their things or anything, considering the name even. But I guess Fujino must have kept a copy of all of his stuff.
Yeah, Fujino seems to be good at keeping his stuff for a long time. I mean, there was Project Moon and the Insanity 12 Stags. I think it was 12 Stag Super Play that came with that.
I believe that's what it was on. Yeah.
Yeah. So I mean, that was from 95, 92.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah. It's quite a long time ago.
I mean, it kind of shows too, but it's very interesting to see that, you know, he's still kept the data as well, so...
Yeah.
He's kept it for that game, he's kept it for this one, and he must have kept it for 12 Stag, because he's ported it to, you know, PS2, 360 now, Windows Phone, so...
Yeah.
So we're at the final boss now, eh?
Oh, really? Yep.
Tends to be a bit of a drag, this one.
Yeah, we're hoping that Delta Zeal will probably redo this boss. At least it would be nice if they did, because it is indeed kind of a drag.
Yeah, or at least fix up some of the issues with it, because it's especially the very last part with the plane that appears from the top is, you know, you blow off all the side parts and it's just, you know, it just sits there. It's definitely a hallmark of a what appears to be an unfinished product in this case.
Really? Oh. Hmm.
Yeah, that's it's generally like the theory is that I'm running with at the moment anyway, is that what we're seeing in MAME is some kind of rushed release, possibly a prototype board, and you know, some of the parts where you see, you know, there's just nothing happening on the screen, like, I mean, now, for example, and with the final boss, and it's particularly with the credits and stuff, it definitely shows an unfinished look to it.
Oh, really?
We're hoping that these will be what gets changed in a 360 release.
Gotcha.
To answer the question in the chat, there is one loop only, and that is this one. And here you see.
I'd hate to see this game with a second loop.
Oh man, this was second loop would be.
Maybe they'll add it in the port.
There is harder difficulties available. If you there is a dip switch setting, I think, for it. And the main difference that I noticed was the, you know, when you go to the first boss and you see some of the holes you see near the engine is actually. They actually shoot bullets at you, and you can't, you know, blow them up or anything. But yeah, you see here, Project G-Stream staff. That's it.
Yeah, there's no staff credits at all, just some concept art.
I think the actual input for the high score here is buggy as well, is it? I remember the last time I mucked with it, it was doing weird things.
Weird. Oh, okay.
Mmm.
Game is over? What the That's a new one.
Yeah. And check out this next part where the ship comes up to the top of the screen and then just disappears. It's the ship that I was telling you about with the newer boards. It's actually present there on the title screen. But it just disappears here.
Huh. Oh, okay. I think I see what you're getting at.
Yeah.
So what else is on this video?
The rest is just a track sequence and showing the high score table.
Okay, cool. Well, all right. I'll show that then. All right, and... yeah, like we mentioned a little bit earlier, we do have another replay to go through. I don't think Trap's going to be here for all of it. He said he's got to do.
Yeah, my download didn't work either. So even if I had the time to do it, I can't. But it was nice hanging out with y'all and getting this game some exposure. Definitely needs it.
Yeah, here.
Indeed. So, the other video is going to be, there's the A route, and this was the A route, is what we understand, and then this other one's the B route, then?
Yeah.
Okay.
With, M-Tune, the guy that came up with these runs, where he's cleared the game, did a first run where he went through all of the A-side alternate stages, so he went... You know, to the left side of the screen when the bosses on stage 2 and 4 died and went to 3A and 5A respectively. And the next video, he actually uses the second player side instead of first player side, which is actually has increased speed.
Okay.
And he's gone on the B side for the stages instead.
Oh, yeah, so this is going to work really well for the show, so we'll be able to show off all of the different stages in essence, basically, if he's just doing the B route. So, but, like, in probably an ideal route, it would probably go to, like, some A and some B, you think?
I believe the B sides are actually worth more, but I haven't experimented too much with it. BP probably knows more about that than I do.
Yeah, definitely seems more rewarding for score if you go to the B stages, if not so much for medal collection, just because the amount of enemies there are is something, like, you just see it in the background of the attract mode there, is something ridiculous amount of enemies that pop up, and you can get lots of those 5,000, 6,000 chains from killing lots of enemies at a time. So it's definitely more rewarding for school that way.
And to answer the question in the chat about the hitbox, if you see that little rotor right in the center that's like spinning animation in the very center, that is the hitbox.
Yeah, it kind of looks like a black spot.
Okay, I see it. It's hard to tell that it's spinning, though.
Yeah, you kind of got to get up close and try to look at it. But
if you're playing the game full screen, you'll see it.
Okay.
Yep, and that's the end of that.
Cool. Well, in this other replay, I guess, hopefully, BP can kind of talk more about exactly what MTOM is trying to do. Because I know we kind of got sidetracked with, the status of Triangle Service and that type of thing. But it doesn't. It's all good. It's all good. But can be
related tangent.
indeed. Oh man. Okay. Well, I suppose we can get the second replay going. If you want to load that up, BP.
Yep, I got it ready to go. Just a matter of hitting the play button.
Great.
All right, and I have stuff to do, so I will watch the rest of the episode later on YouTube. And hope you have a good rest of the episode.
Okay, great. Yeah, thanks. Thanks for coming on.
Track. Yeah, no problem. See ya.
See you later, man.
See ya.
Oh shit! I guess I'm just gonna call him. hey.
Oh, there.
Hey. All right. Well, I think we should be okay. it just result that when he ended the call, it just resulted in me going, "Oh shit." No, we're all good now. Okay. We're back in the call. All right. So, so second video, let's get this thing underway, I suppose. All right. Here comes the countdown. Wait. I'm going to ask the chat if they can hear you. You guys hear BP, right? Before we start, just to make sure.
Oh, I hope you guys can hear. Cool. I mean, my microphone isn't exactly the best, but yeah.
Actually sounds pretty good. All right, then. They can hear you. Cool. All right. Here's the countdown then. 3, 2, 1, click.
All right, here we go. Fun piece of trivia there. The bling that you just hear on the startup there isn't actually on the actual boards. That's an emulation bug. It's pretty sure it's the only one left with this game because everything else works fine. And Trap 15 tried real hard to make sure there was nothing left with the sound banking related stuff. So what's happening at the moment is he's collecting, getting his metal value up.
Whoa.
Yeah, there's the spot where you get medals and stuff with the void bomb. It's very handy.
So that was the void bomb, okay, cool.
Yeah. If you actually go in the center of the void bomb, because all the bullets you know, get converted to metals, you're completely protected from bullets. So, so it's kind of like a easy little survival trick to remain invincible too.
So how do you like choose a void bomb instead of the regular bomb?
Well, the game's a two-button game. I think he's got an auto-fire setup done to a third button, but normally you'd hold it down and you kind of see the ship flickering. I'm not sure how well that shows on the stream, but the ship actually flickers for certain colors after you hold it down. It slows its speed, its moving speed.
Yeah.
And then when you go, it deploys it, kind of like it deploys the main bomb, Raiden Fighter style. It collides with an enemy or particularly with a bullet, it'll turn into the void bomb.
Right, okay, so this whole bomb, gotcha.
Yeah. And one thing I think Trap 15 didn't cover earlier was you had to collect, you can barely see it, but there's particles that come from an enemy when you kill it, and you can actually collect those particles, and you need a minimum of, because they go up in increments of like 4, 8, I think, and you need 50 to be able to deploy a void bomb. You can see it on the right side of the screen now, where the stats, it's got okay,
yeah,
and 208. Obviously, the more particles you've got, the longer the void bomb lasts.
Oh, okay. Okay, that was cool.
Yeah. If you go in the center of the boss, as he dies, you get a fair bit as well. He could have actually gotten a few more particles by crit killing it right after the plane form died, but instead he's gone and milked it for score with the void bomb that he had, which is a good choice.
Oh, yeah.
So this is the part that Trap 15 was saying before, where you blow these tanks up. The ones on the very bottom left that he got aren't actually related, because they go off the screen very quickly, so it'd be, you know, pretty unfair to have to blow those up to get to the segment. But so he triggers this warning segment with all the tanks and stuff, and I think here, just look at these power-ups as he collects them. Nah, didn't see it, but you can actually get extra bombs, like the normal bombs, depending on how many power-ups you collect as well, which is a real obtuse thing we've learned recently, because originally we thought that there was no way to get extra bombs apart from dying, but what's actually the case is what we've figured is every so often when you kill a certain amount of enemies, power-up pops out, and it, you know, goes in a certain pattern going down, and you pick it up and you get your, you know, your weapon item and whatever. Well, what actually happens after that happens a certain amount of times, a bomb item actually spawns underneath it. You can't actually see it, but it's a bit of a buggy sort of behavior, you could say, another one of those hallmarks of an unfinished product. But when you pick up the what appears to just be a normal item, you get an extra bomb as well.
Okay.
You kind of have to watch out a bit carefully for it in the video, because it happens a few times.
Okay. Huh, okay.
And the yet another hallmark of bugginess is with, I don't know if you notice with the power up that's going through at the moment, but it always comes out and looks like it's red, but the color that it changes to is completely different every time. You know, sometimes it just stays red for a really long time, sometimes it goes blue, sometimes it goes green. The actual cycle of where it goes through the items is consistent, but where it starts is randomized, but the picture doesn't show it. So what ends up happening is you know, red pops out of an enemy and you think it's red and you pick it up, but then you've got a blue on your thing.
Weird.
And you go, what the hell? But yeah.
Weird.
It's quite obtuse.
So you just think that's an emulation error?
I think that's consistent with the actual boards, but I think that is a bug that was in the actual game.
Okay. That's fucked up.
So I mean, even in your live stream now, where you've got the picture on the side, you can see where the bomb explosion is. You see the icon on top, and sometimes when you pick up an item, you actually see that bomb icon for a split second, and then you pick that up as well. Yeah, it'll be interesting to see when the 360 port comes out whether these weird nuances, the weirder nuances of the game, is still present, or whether he's fixed those up or not.
Right.
Oh, so where are we at? We're at 3B now, aren't we? That's definitely one of the parts where you see more enemies and stuff pop up as something ridiculous. I mean, he's trying hard to pick up some of the medals and stuff as well. There's definitely in some of the parts here where you're better off just sitting at the bottom of the screen and killing off the popcorns as they arrive. And then for the larger enemies, of course, you go in and you point blank like he's doing with these ones coming in from the side. And the faster you kill them, the more of those ships will appear. So again, it's, it's kind of like a little nuance there.
Cool.
To kill off the flying ships faster and then, get more score as a result,
Yeah, I always like that element of a shmup, like, being more aggressive means getting more enemies. I was kind of like that. Kind of like a score attack mentality.
Just there for a sec.
What's that?
I don't know if anyone else on the chat's noticed, but occasionally when you see lots of explosions happen on the screen, you actually see blocks of the tiles in the background actually mess up as well.
Wow.
Or you see an explosion happen in the top right corner of the screen when you've killed something too far down.
Oh.
And that is also another graphics bug,
right,
within the game that Trap 15 seems to think, well, last we spoke to each other about it anyway, when the first trailers for this came out, that that was one of the things that was actually fixed in the port, so it's not something you'll see. And yes, it was confirmed as a board error. I think Dave K and RTW both stated it was something they saw on their boards, which is the same board as is present in MAME at the moment.
Okay.
So we're up to the stage 3B boss now at the moment, eh? Mm-hmm. You can definitely see some of the very large sort of, like, the Raiden Fighters giant boss influence.
Yeah.
And particularly the 12 stag boss, it looks a lot like that sort of graphics as well, at least to me anyway.
Oh wow, these bullets have gotten a bit different. Those seeking ones, wow.
Yeah, it's definitely a bit of a challenge versus him. Whenever I get to stage 3B myself, that tends to be a bit of a game ender.
That boss looks pretty tough.
Yeah.
Kind of like a mixture of like a Strikers boss with like, I don't even know, it's kind of crazy.
Yeah. It gets a bit of clusterfuck at times, doesn't it?
That was cool though. I did like the huge tracks too. That was a nice touch there.
Yeah, he seems to like that, doesn't he? I mean, a stage 2 boss had the big-ass wheels and then you got the big-ass tracks for the, giant tank, so. Yeah, it's a very interesting thing. But I didn't get the time to actually watch this fully before the SGG Weekly start, started, but I think he triggers the purple sea, the weird event with the popcorns and stuff in this as well.
Okay.
And it's definitely, events like those are definitely rewarding for score as well.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's new. I haven't even seen that before.
Well, how he waited on that, or he didn't kill the one guy?
Yeah, he waits on the last ship, and the aircraft carriers just appear and, you know, spawn the little popcorn planes that lift off from it. It's quite a nice touch, actually. You see them, they're very small on the carrier, and then they grow larger. Sort of like stuff you see in, like, Rayforce and that.
Yeah, I noticed some of the animations are like that. Yeah. It is cool.
Yeah, so kind of, even I'm learning something new about this game now, so kind of learn something new every day.
Mm-hmm.
I noticed I don't know if you noticed the graphics glitching happening, but that seemed to happen a lot more on the stage.
I haven't noticed it, but I might not be paying enough attention.
Oh, yeah, it's only there for like a fraction of a second If you're not really looking out for it, you'd barely notice it, but it is something that some people have noticed, and, you know, kind of makes, they say it makes the game look bad, but it should be more present here when the boss dies, because that boss does a lot of exploding.
I think I may have seen something.
Or if you keep an eye out as this boss dies, it should do it. It's pretty consistent in the way it glitches out. Almost kind of like a slowdown in a cave game, or when the heads-up display disappears, you know?
Mm. Right. I always like that when that happens. I've been playing Ketsuya on the PCB, and it's like the best thing when there's a huge explosion, and it like makes like all these like glitchy graphics. It's like, it's the best thing ever. Because it's like, it makes you feel like you're breaking the game.
Alright, so we're at 3B now.
It's kind of like a salsa type of music going on here.
5B, sorry, yeah. Yeah, it's definitely got some catchy music. I might even just, you know, shut up for a bit so that the audience can hear it, because yeah, it's definitely, it's one of the better tunes.
Yeah, I'll turn it up a little bit and we'll listen to it.
Cool.
Yeah, it is pretty interesting sounding, huh?
Yeah, it's just a shame that it's that the arcade board had an inferior quality, because otherwise it'd be very catchy. I know some people don't like the music that was in Tri-Zeal. I sure don't. I'm not a big fan of the piano stuff, but it's my personal preference. But the Naoto, the same guy that came up with those, actually made these as well, and it's definitely one of his better works, I think. He definitely outdid himself on this one.
Sorry, did you say who the composer was?
Trap 15, and I believe it is Naoto, the guy who who is part of Triangle Service, who did the music for 12 Stag and Tri-Zeal as well.
Okay.
Damn, that's a lot of power-ups.
A lot of just, it's just raining little metals.
Yeah.
They really do come down fast. It's kind of weird.
Mm.
Whoa.
That was weird. How he... Wow. Yeah, the copter boss here is comes down quite quickly, and you, I believe M-Tunes was taking advantage of a certain exploit in this boss that he found, where he's made it, you know, go off to the left side of the screen,
yeah,
where it can't
that?
Shoot at you, so...
Yeah, that was really weird.
Yeah, it's one I saw it once myself in a run, and I completely forgot about it, because, you know, it's... At the time, I didn't really know how to get to stage 5B, but... Yeah, it's definitely one of the interesting nuances.
Man, a stage, like, something about just having clouds makes a stage in a vertical shmup just, like, a lot better.
Yeah,
I think it's.
And I like how it goes from the daytime through sunset to night as well. It's a really nice touch.
That is really cool. I guess it's because of the like sense of depth, which is always cool to see.
Mm.
The clouds and like.
I like this boss too. It's quite a how do you put it? Like it's definitely one of the hallmarks of the Raiden fighters sort of inspiration.
Yeah.
If this doesn't count as a giant boss, I don't know what is.
yeah, I'm definitely getting
it's
that.
It's the biggest thing he's got in any of his games, I'm pretty sure. Especially if you see any of the I think it's some of the posters that's coming out for the Shooting Love bundle. There's an event going on in Japan somewhere where he's giving away these posters, and it's got all the sprite data from 12 Stag and G-Stream both, and you distinctly see this ship, this very boss, just there taking up like one whole corner of the poster, you know? It's fairly large, even for, you know, miniature pixel standards.
Yeah, it's very detailed graphics. I must say.
Hmm.
Like, everything's really clean and crisp looking. It's pretty nice.
Yeah. Very detailed. It's, I mean, Katsuri came out in the same year, and that doesn't have as much detail.
Yeah.
Shoot me now, but. Yeah.
Yeah, you may be true about that in some respect.
Yeah, I mean, that's not to say that Katsuri is a bad looking game, but it's definitely like when you run it in, because you know the ratio of the Polygame Master games, of which Katsuri, Escaluda, Diojo, and them are all part of the actual. It's kind of squished a bit.
Yeah.
Like the actual resolution's a bit weird. And so when you stretch that back to a 4:3 aspect ratio, it kind of looks a bit squished. Whereas with this, it was obviously intended for this resolution in mind. And so you see very much how detailed the art is.
Yeah. That's a good point.
I swear that metal just went white through him then. Yeah, and because I've got my video running and I've got the actual stream with me in it going, and it looks like it there too. But
yeah,
it might be a part of when a boss dies, you actually can't collect any power ups that appear on the screen.
Yeah, maybe.
So if
maybe.
You die just before, then you're kind of screwed, basically.
Yeah. Seems like a lot of the times he's not that concerned about the medals, whereas sometimes, well, other times he is. Is it just because he doesn't. I mean. Is it just
the medals aren't everything for scoring in the game, and it's kind of because the amount that do drop, it's, you know, there's a lot that do drop, but it also doesn't take a lot to actually bring it back up to max value as well.
I see. Okay, yeah.
So you kind of have to look at it a bit, because some people from, like, you know, playing Battle Gregor and Rising games and seeing, you know, having to drop the medals all the time and think, oh my god, that's, you know, a horrible scoring mechanic, what a nightmare. But it's, I kind of have to wean yourself out of that look,
yeah,
out of that approach to, you know, really, that, and that's where it makes a lot more sense.
I see. So it just doesn't really matter that much towards his score if he's just kind of, yeah, playing the game.
Yeah, because I imagine the I've heard from somewhere. To be honest, I've forgotten where it was. I heard it from. It might have been something Trap 15 said. But apparently, the world record for this game is some 8 million points. And if you actually see what this dude has gotten at the end, it's not that far off. I mean, it's 5.8 mil.
Yeah.
And it's even the A score run that he was doing before was higher than, well, anything in Shmup's Forms high score thread anyway. But you know, whether that's part of just not knowing enough about the game, or that no one really knows the game exists, is, you know, I'd leave that up to you to judge. But there's definitely room for more scoring improvement in this, I think. But I wouldn't say it's entirely all about the medals either.
Okay.
And to answer a few of the questions in the chat, I don't know if you noticed some of the, how do you put it, like the tiling is a bit off with the animation of some of the sprites and stuff is actually running, it's kind of like playing Raiden Fighters on Shmup MAME or something, you know, where the sprite buff has been disabled.
Yeah.
It might exist on the board. I've not seen it for certain. It's not really for me, it's never really been a big deal. This game's pretty much lagless as it is. I'd rather they didn't add a sprite buffer, to be honest. If they did, I'd just make a new version of MAME that ripped it back out again. But
Oh, that's good to hear that. At least, it's pretty lagless. That's pretty good.
It's only some, I think at the moment it's only got 2 frames, you know.
That's pretty good.
And it moves on the second frame sort of thing. So it's a bit more laggy than Raiden Fighters on Shmup MAME, but not by much. It's definitely very, very responsive controls, I think. It's just a matter of getting used to the ship being slow.
Yeah. I like the, ship
slow.
I like the ship speed, though. It looks like it kind of controls very smoothly. It looks like it's fun to control.
Oh yeah, definitely. It's especially those moments when you know, moving left or right or whatever, and you, because the actual part I forgot actually, the, what do you call it, the hitbox that for collecting medals is actually reduced when you turn, so you kind of, you know, have to balance a little bit between having your ship out wide to, if you're trying to collect medals at that time, or you know, just dodge the bullets, you know.
Yeah, it was funny. I saw an enemy like this that you can't destroy, yet it shoots at you in the last stage of Caladrius, which came out recently.
Oh yeah.
In the last stage, it's just like this bitch, like, little, like, option that just shoots at you the whole time during the stage, and you can't kill it.
Yes.
It's, like, really annoying.
Yeah, well, this dude's actually managed to go through that segment quite quickly, so which is the main reason why that thing kept on shooting it. But there's other things that come in from the sides if you are there long enough, but you can kill the boss and everything easily enough so that never happens. Maybe in the 360 port that will get changed, so that they appear instantly and it adds to the challenge. Who knows? It'll be interesting to see regardless. I think some of the patterns in this segment here are actually have been borrowed and used in some of the later titles.
Yeah.
Seen one of the bosses in 12 Stag actually did that front one with the bullets as well.
Oh, geez. Once again, I was surprised by the sudden ending.
Yeah.
And yeah, that ranking, you can't even put a name in.
Yeah. It's kind of just a bit all over the place with that.
2 at SR. The heck.
Now, I noticed there's a few bugs with the high scoreboard, particularly if you start the game fresh and do, like, your first run, and more so if you're on the second side playing, it tends to glitch up on the scoreboard a bit, where what tends to happen is you get, like, it wants you to put in a name for first and second player, and it shows it got one person for just whatever scores on the board before, and you're trying to, you know, set first player's name, and then your score's kind of popped up underneath or above it or somewhere. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of weird. Mm-hmm. I'll say that. Right.
Oh, wow, that the blue laser powered up looks pretty neat.
Yeah, it's
I don't think we ever saw that from Mtomb. And he never powered it up that much.
Yeah, no, he mainly used the wide shot. Yeah. But I think, I'm fairly sure it's kind of like riding in the way that the wide shot up close for point blanking deals more damage than the laser. But yeah, the laser is just generally better for the piercing side of thing.
Right.
And it's usually what I would do is have either fully leveled wide shot or funny comment on the chat there.
Yeah.
But yeah, I either have just full wide shot or just like almost full wide shot and one or two laser, so that you've just got the laser for piercing stuff.
Oh,
but
yeah,
then most of your power is still in the wide shot.
That is true.
Well, I suppose it's a matter of how you play and preference, because, you know, I mean, you can do so much.
Yeah.
With the distribution of your power-ups, so.
Indeed. Indeed. Alright, well, I guess that's pretty much gonna wrap it up. I mean, you have anything to add about the gameplay mechanics that we missed out on talking about, or anything like that, or?
I don't think there was off the top of my head, there's nothing I'm pretty sure that was that I hadn't covered. There's probably some parts here that even I don't know. There's there's the destructible bullets. They actually do add up to that that chain meter that I was telling you about, where you get the 5,000 or whatever. That's why in the early stages where you see him shoot the destructible enemies, he shoots them a lot, but without killing the enemies themselves, and just gets heaps of score from that. But yeah, it's definitely an obscure game, very rare, kind of buggy in some places, hopefully not as much in the 360 port. Should definitely buy the 360 port.
So what? You've got the money for it. Yeah, about that, about the port that's coming out, what's the what's the full title of the release?
Full name, I believe, is Shooting Love, 10th Anniversary, 12 Zeal, and Delta Zeal.
Okay.
With 12 Zeal being 12 Stag, just, you know, renamed, and Delta Zeal being this, pretty much.
But it also comes with G-Stream, is that correct? Or?
Well, Delta Zeal is kind of, the way that Fujino is talking about it, it's the finished product based on G-Stream.
Oh, okay.
I'll give you a link to the trailer, or actually, I'll even show you this one that just popped up the other day is I'll put it in a chat for others to show.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's they've renamed this, called it Delta Zeal, and changed a bit, you know, made the title screen look different, and the maybe changes to the final boss ending, you know, unspecified changes that he's mentioned. Gotcha. Who knows, you know, gotcha. Kind of, we'll find out on release, I guess, but
gotcha. It'll okay. be
very interesting to see, as should definitely buy it. It's region free. It's I think the price was cheapest at Amy last time I checked. It was a little bit more than some of the cave titles, but worth it.
Yeah, I mean, if you're interested, and you know, and then you can give it a shot in meme somehow as well. And yeah, definitely. I'm definitely interested now too. I didn't really know what to expect with this game or Trizeal. I don't really know much about Trizeal either, but the fact that it's coming out and it's region free is just, it's just plain awesome. So yeah.
Yeah. Good news indeed.
It's just good news in general. And yeah, I mean, it looks like a pretty solid game. And I definitely am curious about the finished product, so to speak, of G-Stream. So man, it just,
yeah, so it'll be, it's definitely, it's solid as it is. I expect it'll probably be even better in the 360 port. It's kind of just it's a little bit of a shame that it's gone unnoticed for this long, because you know, it gets associated with the Oriental Soft title, who came up with they've got one other game in the MAME library, which was 1945 K3, and that was a mess, that game. It was just, you know, stolen graphics everywhere, and just,
man,
kind of wonky in general, whereas this is like, you know, it's pure awesome solid manic gameplay, you know.
It seems a little weird, just that the fact that the, you know, this Shooting Love is coming out, I mean, again, it seems like, yeah, I mean, like, this, the developers really just want to, like, you know, prove something with this release or something like that. Because
Well, I had because I had the, you know, Shooting Love 2007 and Shooting Love 2000X, I think it was called, for the 360, and you can see some of the stuff in that. With, I don't own the game myself, to be honest. It's region locked. I don't own a Japanese 360. I'd buy it if I could, but I can't.
Yeah, I've always wanted to.
But from what I've seen and heard of it, there's definitely a lot in there that is based, that is actually based directly off G-Stream as well. There's even a section where it looks almost word, you know, pixel for pixel, like the section in Stage 2, for example, where the tanks pop up.
I see. Yeah, those Shooting Love, I remember checking out that a bit. They're pretty cool. Like, they have, like, some mini games. I think one of my favorite mini games in the Shooting Love was, it was like some paper balls are like being thrown to a trash can, and like you gotta bump them with your shot to like get them in there. You gotta nudge them in from the bottom. So it's just it's got funny.
I had some funny mini games in that one.
Yeah.
I think there was one where it goes like Wild West, and you gotta, you know, the countdown goes down from 3, 2, 1, and you gotta be the first person to press the fire button, or it drops a 20k weight on you, cartoon style.
Oh man. Cool. All right,
but
well,
you definitely see where Fujino, where Triangle Service has gone, or where they got some of their ideas for their later titles from in the form of this game. So it's kind of, apart from being a good game being finally realized, fully finished, it's kind of a piece of history as well. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Lost for words at the moment.
That's all good. We're wrapping it up anyway. But yeah, I think people are probably interested now in the game, and yeah, maybe they'll pick up the release. But hey, ain't much else to say, so I guess this is going to conclude SCG Weekly number 21 for G2020. Do you know anything about the story of the game, by the way?
I'm pretty sure there isn't one. Fujino is actually name-dropped Raiden, has a bit of a reference in terms of what inspired him on the Triangle Service page, and Raiden didn't have much of a story. Nah. It was kind of just shoot shit and not die, you know?
It's
definitely a man's game, you could almost say. None of the modern anime characters shoehorning a story into a shmup. It's just a good game with good gameplay.
Yeah. the manly part is probably those mech tracks on the bosses and the big and the big wheels. Like, that's pretty manly.
Yeah, huge wheels. Never seen a boss with huge wheels like
big
that.
Big rims. All right, cool. Well, yeah, thanks a lot, BP, for coming on the show and talking about the game. Definitely enlightened us all.
Oh, it was a pleasure to be on.
Indeed. And, thanks to M-Tomb as well for the gameplay and the replays for the game. He wanted to be on the show, but I guess he couldn't get a mic set up or something like that. But he provided a nice asset in any case. So I think that'll do it. That's all. All right. Later, folks.
Gotcha.